Welcome to the show, David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Well, we have a very special show today. This is as good as it gets. Frank Conniff is here, and we have a birthday present for you.
Oh, that's exciting.
Well, I didn't know it was going to be a present. I just thought I was going to be a guest.
We have a stripper with Leah McEnany is also with us.
I do strip occasionally, but as a birthday present, I'm going to keep my clothes on.
You are freshly shaved today.
I did. I did. That's the wrong way to answer your question, but I shaved today, yes. I had a slip with the electric razor and decided to go with it.
The Pope is here in Manhattan. Mm-hmm.
Is he here already?
He's here. He's performing in Central Park.
That's right. Just like Simon and Garfunkel and Elton John.
Yeah, they're showing the happening in Central Park. It's going to be on this Saturday.
And you told me Jim Gaffigan is performing for the Pope.
Tomorrow in Philadelphia.
Really?
Saturday, yeah.
What, is he opening for him? Or
yes, he has a...
Oh, he's performing and the Pope is in the audience?
Yeah, it's going to be like a gala event. I know Aretha Franklin's on the lineup, but I don't know who else is going to be there.
It's not the Pope's Young Comics special for HBO. He doesn't do that. This Pope doesn't do that.
Well, that's a good... Jim is a good choice. You know, he's clean, and I think he's kind of religious and stuff, so, and he's very funny. So.
And as prophesied by St. Malachi, he's also the Antichrist that's going to bring the end of times.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me. I'm getting a little touched here. Mm-hmm.
That sure is some nice coffee that Alex made you.
Yes, he did.
I sure would love some coffee right now. Sure would love some coffee.
Coffee, Dad. Are you making a joke about Coffee Dad on Twitter, or you really do want coffee?
No, I really want
some
coffee.
Oh, okay. You know about Coffee Dad, right?
No, I don't.
We'll show it to you later. Okay. Frank Conniff, where were you when you found out that Steve Renazzisi lied about where he was on 9/11?
Well, I'd never heard of him before, and I think I heard about it yesterday, the day before, and...
Where were you?
Well, I think I was... at home, but I was really incensed, and I have to say that what he did is worse than 9/11.
Well, at least he admitted to lying about 9/11, which is more than can be said about Cheney
and
Bush.
That's very true.
Yeah. I mean, he came clean. Uh-huh. We're taping this on a Friday. His special airs tomorrow
night, yeah.
On Comedy
now,
Central.
Now, suddenly I'm interested in seeing it. I never heard of him before. And now we can watch it all in the context of anything he says. It's like, oh, what an asshole. You know?
Can you believe that the Pope's going to be stuck watching Gaffigan while Steve Ranazzisi's special is on Comedy Central?
What do you think is more traumatic? Surviving 9/11. Uh-huh. What did he say? He didn't say he was...
He said he was in the building and that he went out because he had to grab a pad of paper to make up a story. And he went out and then the plane crashed and then the other one came in and then he didn't know if his mother was alive. You know, it was like this whole traumatic thing.
So he had to run into Tower 2 to find out if his mother was there. And then he ran out and survived that one.
Is that what he said?
No, but that would be that'd be pretty crazy if he did.
What he's going through right now, I think, is worse than having to survive 9/11. And he deserves a lot of sympathy.
Someone told me he has a commercial. He got just signed to do like Hot Wings commercials or something like that.
Buffalo Wild Wings.
Yeah, and now it's probably not going to happen. I mean, that's devastating when you book a commercial and then it gets canceled. I've never booked a commercial, so I wouldn't know what that's like.
Is there a support group for?
I hope so because
Paul McCartney is going to be doing a live concert on NBC to raise money to.
You know, when you don't...
Don't give me that look, David.
When you lose a commercial gig, the first thing you say is, we must never forget. it's just the whole thing is very bizarre to me. But apparently, like I read somewhere, like it was like part of his career, apparently. Like it's part of his origin story that he realized after he survived 9/11 that he wanted to do something with his life and... he decided he wanted to lie about 9/11, and I wasn't savvy enough when 9/11 happened to think I got to come up with a story that'll really help my career. You know?
Yeah, it's weird because he did it. He did that story on like Conan. He did it
and on Marin, right?
On Marin, he did it on the Sklar Brothers. The thing was, he was saying like I was a very young man, and you know I was hoping that by being quiet about it would blow over. But meanwhile, he's been talking about it as recently as 2 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. And I know that the Marin thing, I think, was 2009, and that's only like 5 years ago or whatever, you know.
So what happens to him?
I don't know. I mean, that's an interesting interesting thing to see. Who knows? Like, you know, James Frey, remember A Million Little People, remember all that? Yeah. He bounced back very well out of that. He started writing young adult books. He sold a lot of them to the movies, and he's made a ton of money since then. So you can come back from something like that, you know.
Or he might just be put into a camp for 15 years without being tried. Or,
well, it is stolen valor, which is
yeah. In fact, and we were talking about it on Fugelsang's show, and then someone brought up the fat Jew, and then I was like, oh, the fat Jew is worse than that. And then I realized afterwards, no, the fat Jew isn't worse than that, because the fat Jew, as horrible as he is that he's stealing material, this guy is like you said, he's stealing the valor of he's exploiting the deaths of people, and that's actually worse.
I don't know if that's true. If you had to choose between, there's only one slot in hell, the fat Jew or Steve Ranazzisi.
I would probably go with the fat Jew, but
I would have to put the fat Jew in now, because he hurt people. I mean, he's stealing people's bits and making money off it. Steve Ranazzisi, what did he... I mean, it's horrible what he's done, but he hasn't hurt a specific human being.
No, he really hasn't hurt anybody. It's just very, like, tasteless, and it ruins your, you know...
He's ruined 9/11 for me.
It used totally to be hilarious.
Yeah. I can no longer enjoy 9/11.
But I feel like as someone who was in New York when that happened, and I went down and volunteered on the Spirit of New York, anchored outside of Ground Zero.
And Liam's making up a story about how he volunteered.
Me and my wife, you know, we were in the trains. We were about to go to work when the planes
Thank you.
But as someone who was there and who remembers just how emotionally charged it was and how upset everybody was,
right?
You know, like I wandered into the 9/11 memorial a couple of months ago by accident, because I was just walking through downtown, and I just started crying. Like I just started like weeping uncontrollably.
It's not that expensive.
No, I was in the free part.
Okay.
But seriously, like I, you know, like as someone who was really. Like, you know, this whole city was very emotionally affected by that. And to see someone using that story, like the story of people who were there, as a way to fucking get spots at the Comedy Store.
Yeah. My niece was in Stuyvesant High School, which is right by there, which they used as a staging area for the – that's how close it was.
Right.
And she was in school when it happened. And she was, you know, very young. And she – has genuinely had real problems of like post-traumatic stress and real like just stuff that she had to, and she's doing great now, you know, but stuff that she had to work through. So people really, not just the people that were killed, or I mean people who were involved in it in some way or the other really suffered.
And David, I mean, he doesn't like to talk about it, but he had like a dozen friends on the planes hijacking them.
Oh yes, I as I said, that I didn't think it was possible for Steve Ranazzisi to actually offend Muhammad Atta's father.
You know, it's super weird.
And by the way, those box cutters, I kept walking because I had lent them some box cutters, and apparently walking around Ground Zero trying to get back the box. They won't return them.
Oh, that's too bad.
Or give me money for the box cutters.
You know, what's super weird, and this is actually true, is James Woods witnessed those guys during a dry run before September 11th.
He literally
witnessed the hijackers on a plane just fucking doing like a dry run, like on the flight.
And then they didn't go through it because they're big James Woods fans. He said, let's do another flight when there's no celebrities on the plane.
Well, they hadn't seen any of his movies post The Godfather. So right.
James Woods wasn't in The Godfather.
Wasn't he in The Godfather?
No.
No, come on. He played Sonny, right?
No, that's James Caan.
Oh, well, then I think...
Is that who you're thinking of?
Well, if my friends in Al-Qaeda had known the difference, maybe the...
Jimmy Caan was on a plane with...
No, it was James Woods.
Oh, it was James Woods.
I get those two mixed up. What can I say? Listen, as a 22-year-old, that's a lot of old man stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm. What is the pathology behind this? Because it's more than just attaching yourself to some heroic feat. There is a thrill about telling a big lie.
I guess, yeah.
Right?
I get a thrill every time I tell myself my career is going to do well. That's a big lie. But, I guess it's, I think it's just about creating, you know, not feeling you yourself are adequate enough, your own life. And a lot of people do this, you know, and they invent stories about themselves. And
I think there's a thrill. I think it's like gambling. I think it's the idea that you're getting away with something and you could get caught. That might be. That's what I think it is. I think...
It also might have just been like something he just came up with out of the back of his head and it just snowballed and people responded to it and he made it bigger and bigger and it got out of his control, you know? Mm-hmm.
With Brian Williams, I was talking with some lawyers and some lawyers say, you know, NBC was kind of sort of right for taking him back. Mm-hmm.
If they put him back in the anchor chair, I wouldn't care because what he did was so the least of his crimes against journalism, as was NBC's crimes against journalism. You know, so the whole thing is ridiculous to me in the first place. You know that he lied about his experiences in Iraq and he got in trouble for that, but he's not in trouble for telling the lies that got us into Iraq, you know. I think we've talked about this before. He had war profiteers on the NBC Nightly News to analyze and discuss the war, all the while they were profiteering from the fact that there was a war and it was never revealed.
You're
on
talking
the
about
air.
The generals. Right.
The generals, yeah. And it was never revealed on the air and it only came out later when the New York Times wrote a Pulitzer Prize winning story about it.
General Electric was speaking.
You know, whether he's on NBC or not.
Thank you.
You know, when you consider that Chuck Todd and Joe Scarborough are on and Chris Matt, I mean, it's you know, it doesn't even matter. It makes no difference.
What I think is interesting is you get a lot of people now on the internet who are saying things like, and there's a lot of people, it's not just like a small sample, saying, well, why is what the Fat Jew did wrong? Why is what Brian Williams did wrong? Why is what Steve Ranazzisi did wrong? And I think it's more interesting that there's this kind of like a ethical tilt towards saying like, well, you know, fuck it. People, you know, just say what you say. The important thing is that it's entertaining.
There's a culture of the internet is something you can just take whatever you want from it, you know, and it's just there. And everything is free, you know, so you can just take it. So there's this thing that people like the Fat Jew try to get away with of like, I'm just aggregating, you know, I'm just curating. That's another word he uses. And he did get away with that, and he's still getting away with it.
What is he doing these days?
I don't know. I haven't. I did notice, like right a few blocks from here, his picture is on like a Seamless ad, like a big Seamless ad. So, I've really been wasting my life writing my own jokes. Is all I can say.
How many lies do you think you could tell? I have a theory that you get to a certain level of competence as a comedian or somebody in show business, and then you can tell one big lie every day and nobody will catch you at it. I think if you've been doing it for 10 years, if you've been in the business 10 years and you decide to tell one big lie, you'll never get caught.
But he got caught. I mean, the Times fact-checked his story finally. I mean, why, you know, and so...
Well, he didn't tell enough lies. I think he should have had just so many lies.
And it's only kind of a fluke that Brian Williams was ever caught, because it was just that the Stars and Stripes did the story about it, and he screwed himself up because he did a whole presentation at this hockey or basketball game
right.
with a veteran, and the people from Stars and Stripes or the other veterans who were on the helicopter said, oh, this is all bullshit. And that's what got the whole thing started.
Do you think Brian Williams knew he was lying? Do you think Steve Renazzisi knew he was lying?
With Brian Williams, I think it's an open question, because I think people like him live in such a world of bullshit that I don't know if it's true. They don't always right. know. They create... He was paid to create that image of himself. Mm-hmm. You know, in a way, he was kind of doing his job, you know, to create the illusion of this world globe-trotting anchorman who's been in danger and stuff. And you know, he was really doing what he was paid to do until he was caught lying about it.
Right. Well, yeah. Did you watch the town hall in New Hampshire with Donald Trump yesterday?
Last night.
A Trump supporter made some Islamophobic remarks and falsely accused President Obama of being a Muslim,
mm-hmm.
which is false. We all know he's a Scientologist. Trump neglected to challenge or correct the supporter. Does this prove through this that Trump coverage, the mainstream media, is carelessly giving these fringe right-wing anti-Islamic voters a voice and an outlet?
Yeah, they're giving them an outlet in the form of Donald Trump, who is spewing hate speech, and because he brings such ratings, the media is just—they're literally MSNBC and CNN is doing it too. They're literally just showing his speeches in their entirety. If he's making a speech, they interrupt their programming, and they just show the entire speech. And same thing with a press conference. So the media is as they always are. They're very culpable in this, and they're really the main problem.
What is Godwin's law?
Godwin's law
that if you bring up Hitler, you've lost the argument.
I never heard that. I thought you meant that God. I just lost my headphones, but I thought
that's
you meant,
also part of Godwin's law.
I thought you Godwin's law was like he won God won law or something.
Yeah. There's also the 1 hour crime drama that you and I produce for CBS, Godwin's Law. They say if you bring up Hitler in an argument, you've lost, to which I reply, you know, my dad fought in World War II.
Mm-hmm. Allegedly.
Allegedly.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's okay to bring up Hitler. And I think it's okay to compare Trump to Hitler.
In Trump's case, I agree, because Trump is literally talking about getting elected president and rounding up citizens and putting them in boxcars and sending them away. So
also, I would say what's interesting is the media's take was that this guy said, you know, President Obama is a Muslim, mm-hmm. and then, you know, Trump said nothing. But mm-hmm. if you actually listen to it, I played this thing, the Zapruder film mm-hmm. this morning.
Mm-hmm.
If you listen to it, the guy says, yeah, you know, President Obama is a Muslim. And then Trump goes, yeah. And then the guy continues
with
his point.
Well, yeah, I mean, Trump, I think... I don't know if he's been questioned about this yet, but I think he—that's part of his. I don't know what he really believes or not, but it's part of his shtick. And they did a poll. Most of his supporters believe that. Most of his supporters believe Obama is a Muslim, and most of his supporters believe Obama was not born in America. So the scientific explanation for his popularity is that people are fucking idiots.
Now, here's my question, is if the first black president is raising this kind of, you know, anger and homophobia, Islamophobia, what's going to happen if he's followed by Bernie Sanders, the first Jewish president?
Well, yeah, or Hillary Clinton, you know, it'll be this. I think there's a part of the country that's so pissed off that we have a black president. I think it's just destroyed their world that could happen in a great country like ours, where we once had a great tradition of segregation and racism, that we could stoop to the level where we would make a black man the president of the United States, I think is very upsetting to a lot of people.
If Bernie Sanders becomes president, and you know what? Stranger things have happened.
Stranger things have happened, but not this.
But not that. A socialist Jew who becomes president.
Uh-huh.
My gut tells me that the Republicans hate Jews so much that they can't even go there.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what they we love Israel, we love, but they really hate the Jews, and nobody ever asks them, am I going to go to heaven with you? Because that's the big question mm-hmm. that they should be asked when they bring mm-hmm. up Jesus.
I think they think the Jews are going to get like condos in the very southern uh-huh. part of heaven where it's sunny all the time.
My spider sense tells me that the ultra-right wing, the Islamophobes, mm-hmm. are too frightened to open up their hatred for Jews and are just going to keep it with the Muslims.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Muslims, it's very easy to be a right-winger and have Muslim hatred. It's accepted in a lot of areas of our culture. So, yeah, absolutely.
Just like that kid with the clock down in Texas
mm-hmm.
who was arrested for bringing a homemade clock to
right.
to his school. You know, and so people... You
half
know,
a bomb, as they say. That was what the right wing was saying. He brought half a bomb to school.
Yeah, he brought the wrong... he brought the wrong
and Obama
half of the bomb.
Invited him to the White House, and he did bring a bomb with him, but he got past Obama's Secret Service.
yeah. You know, Frank, mm-hmm. school us. Everybody cites...
Don't ask me to school you on anything.
Everybody talks about that great moment that mm-hmm. McCain had when the mm-hmm. woman who looks like Bruce Valanche called Obama an Arab. Remember that?
Yes, I do.
And they go, this was,
but you know, she had a great T-shirt on, though. But
what did the shirt say?
No, I don't know, because Bruce Valanche oh, right. is known for his T-shirt.
She looked like Bruce Valanche, and she said, you know, Obama's an Arab. Tell what McCain did wrong. They always talk about how great he was with that.
Well,
Muppet.
Here's the thing, is he said... no, he's not a Muslim. He's an American.
He's a good man.
He's a good man, not a Muslim.
Right.
So right there, that never comes up. Where no one ever says, well, so what if he was a Muslim?
Right.
He'd still
right.
be an American. But people point to that as an example of McCain's character. But on the other hand, McCain lost. You know, maybe that was the wrong strategy. Maybe he should have said, yeah. Like Trump is doing, you know.
Let me ask you about Obama being a Muslim.
Mm-hmm. Which is true.
By the way, just for the record, just because he's from Kenya doesn't necessarily mean he's
right.
a Muslim.
Is he CIA? Was he vetted by the CIA early on and kind of had a fast track in?
In what sense?
Well, if he's a young American growing up in Indonesia and traveling around the world, is it conceivable that somebody at the CIA spotted him and then they spotted him at Columbia and at Harvard Law School and they kind of guided him and saw him for I'm sure he has an enormous IQ.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying you're presenting this as part of the scenario that he really wasn't born in America. Is that what you're doing?
I'm saying he was born in America. I'm just throwing out there.
But when he was in the Muslim training camps in Indonesia.
I just wonder the time spent in Indonesia, was he spotted by the CIA and groomed?
Dude, the CIA couldn't spot the 9/11 hijackers. James Woods spotted the 9/11 hijackers.
That's a good point. And
I mean, let alone young Obama's potential to be president.
Okay, what happens if Trump gets the nomination?
If Trump gets the nomination, my prediction, and it's really not smart to make predictions at this point, but my prediction is he loses to Hillary in a historic landslide.
Okay.
Even worse than Reagan Mondale?
Yeah, probably. Mondale carried what, Minnesota?
Yeah. You know.
Massachusetts.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think, I don't think that's going to happen. I think Trump is going to get bored. And I also think that I don't think there's anything Trump can say or do that will bring him down in the polls, that will ruin his campaign. But I think there might be Trump fatigue might set in because he's so overexposed now that just in show business terms, you know, because this is show business we're talking about, you know, like on The Apprentice, which was his big TV show, he was a guy that came in at the beginning of the show and the end of the show, you know. The show wasn't about him. You didn't watch Trump for an hour, and so people didn't get sick of him. He was kind of this unseen presence for the show. He's not the kind of celebrity that you want to have. Like, if you're doing a show with him, you don't want him to be the lead and be in every scene. You know, mm-hmm. you want to use him sparingly. And now, in this new TV show he's on, he's the lead in every scene. He's on all the time. And I think that he might just become overexposed and people just might get sick of him.
And there's also no character arc. Like, it's just...
Yeah, because there's no character.
Yeah, he's got no character. But but there's no, like... There's no progression where he's like, okay, well, this is also what I believe.
Yeah, we all know what he is already. Yeah. Everything that he is something that's already been absorbed by everybody. So,
well, let me ask you this.
Uh-huh.
When George W. Bush was running for president,
mm-hmm.
did you think he would be as bad a president as he turned out to be?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
You knew that he would...
Well, his whole thing was like, what America needs now is a businessman. Mm. They need a CEO in chief.
Right, right.
And then you looked at every business that he ran before he was president.
Yeah, he was a failure.
He was a failure in every one. So it's just like, before 9/11, the economy was tanking really fast. And, you know, there were all these op-eds that were calling him a one-term president in the first year of his presidency.
And one of the tragedies of the modern age is that not enough people... progressive people in the year 2000 and also media people realized the looming emergency that was happening was that George W. Bush and Dick Cheney could potentially become elected president. Of course, they weren't elected, but they got in the White House anyway. And people were very there wasn't a great deal of concern about that. In fact, if you read the New York Times, if you read Frank Rich, if you read Maureen Dowd, what you read was that there was really essentially no difference between Al Gore and George W. Bush. And George Bush actually got more favorable coverage in the Times and in the press in general. So that's a tragedy that there was not – people didn't have an urgency that, you know, no matter what, we have to stop these people from getting elected, and people were very blasé about it, and the result is disaster for the country and the deaths of tens of thousands of people.
And millions of people in Iraq.
Yeah.
Under Clinton, we had 8 years of growing economy and good times. An argument could be made that it was built on sand.
Mm-hmm. But I had health insurance.
So the Democrats fix the country. We get lulled into complacency, and we say, "Hey, let's vote for a moron. Anybody can do this."
Yeah. And the press was so hated the Clintons as they do to this day, and you're seeing that same kind of coverage of Hillary now. And they hated Gore because they thought he was a dork, and they associated him with Clinton, and they just people were favorable towards George W. Bush. And then even after the Iraq War, in his reelection campaign, George Bush got very favorable coverage from the press.
I mean, also, you know, there was just the issue of, like, I was a young voter then. You know, maybe it was my second presidential election. But I really bought into the whole there's no difference between me and a lot of my friends who are, like, very liberal, very progressive people. Mm. We all bought into the idea that, like, you know, there's no difference between Al Gore and George W. Bush fundamentally. Mm. And then 4 years later, Al Gore's getting the fucking Nobel Prize for his work with the environment, and George W. Bush is a disaster.
Yeah.
With Bush and Trump, because I think Hitler has the potential.
I think Hitler has the potential to go all the way this year.
Also, another thing, though, about Trump is, like, we look at it as this unbelievably worst-case scenario of him getting elected. We had the worst case scenario. We had Bush and Cheney getting elected, and Jeb Bush has Paul Wolfowitz as an advisor and has all of the old Iraq people. So I don't even necessarily know that Trump getting elected president is scarier than Jeb Bush getting elected president.
But Jeb said during the debate that his brother kept us safe.
Yes, because...
he turned the country over to other people.
Well, yeah, there was just that slight thing on September 11th that happened. But other than that, you know, he kept us
He held down my pet goat, you know, when the country really needed it. Mm. Well, but would people vote for a President Bush for the third time? I mean, do you feel like
Jeb? I don't think. I mean, and it has as much to do with just Jeb's inadequacy as a candidate than it does with the fact that he's a Bush, I think.
When I saw his logo and it just said Jeb with no Bush, I laughed to myself because I was like, I think even he knows that that name is
and
poison.
Did you see when he introduced himself at the debate and he said, my name is Jeb Bush, I'm an only child?
When George W. Bush was running,
it'll
separate him from Dick Cheney. Don't you think that that George W. Bush kind of just wanted to be president? It would be fun. He really didn't have an agenda. He just thought, this is something I can do.
Yeah, he wandered into the, you know, because he failed at everything else.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I think it's been said before. I didn't come up with it. If he had been made the commissioner of baseball, like, he never would have run for president. That's
right.
What he really wanted. And since
why is Trump running?
Trump is running, I think, just because it's a gigantic ego trip for him. I think he's having a lot of fun.
Right.
I think that's one of the things that separates him from everyone else and why he's doing so well, because basically he doesn't give a shit. He says whatever he wants, and he's for an egomaniac like him to be getting the unbelievable amount of attention that he's getting must be the biggest high for him. And I think no matter what happens, if he leaves the race tomorrow, he comes out of this like bigger than ever, richer than ever. His brand is bigger than ever.
Do you think
it's richer
than ever? Because he's been fired from a lot of, his gigs.
No, I don't think that's all. I think that after this election, I think that his brand, the Trump brand, I think will be really strong and he'll be able to put his name on a lot of things.
Because he's been replaced by Schwarzenegger on Celebrity Apprentice now.
Yeah.
What happens to Trump if, God forbid, there is a big, big terrorist attack in this country? Say around the time of, he's doing okay in the Iowa caucus in New Hampshire, and suddenly there's a big terrorist attack. Could he find himself in a position that he didn't want to be in, the same way George W. Bush didn't want to be a wartime president?
What do you know, David? What are your buddies in ISIS telling you?
I think a terrorist attack, a big 9/11 scale attack, is the best thing that could happen to the Republicans. It's the one thing that could put them in the White House because they totally scored off of that the last time, because their whole thing is based on fear.
But given what happens to our Constitution, what happens to what's left of our rights, and what happens to Donald Trump? When I say he reminds me of Hitler, don't you think that circumstances could turn him into something that even he isn't planning on becoming?
Yeah, I mean, I think, I don't know if he wants history to call his bluff. I don't know if he ever wants to really be in a situation where he has to make those kind of heavy duty decisions. I've heard other people say, I don't know if it's true, but he really wants to drop out at a certain point. He wants to ride this thing and get all he can out of it, but he doesn't really want to be president. Although I don't know if that's true, but it was true of Ross Perot, who was leading in the polls and then suddenly realized, oh, shit, I could win this thing. And he dropped out of the race saying because it was his daughter's wedding or something like that.
But then he came back.
Yeah, then he came back, but he screwed himself up. And I think ultimately it just scared the shit out of him that he might actually become president.
Also, I mean, don't you think a big 9/11 scale attack would be better for the Democratic Party? Because wouldn't people feel like they want to stay the course and stick?
Oh, I don't know, because, Obama has been very strong in terms of terrorism, not necessarily in a good way. I mean, he's drone killed the shit out of people, and but he captured bin Laden, and all of the stuff that military hawks would want, he's given them. He's been very, if you're a hawk, you should really be happy with Obama as a president. But I don't know if the public has that perception.
Carly Fiorina, seems to have fabricated a story about when she claimed that there are tapes of Planned
Parenthood. She hasn't seemed to have. She has fabricated the story.
She fabricated.
And then it's said in the New York Times, appears to have, and it's like that's the New York, typical of the New York Times right. to hedge their bets like that.
It's like there appears to be yeah. weapons of mass destruction mm-hmm. in Iraq, so we should go in and
well,
get
them. Well, this is what she says she saw. She saw a video of a fully formed fetus on the table, mm-hmm. its heart beating, its legs kicking, while someone is overheard saying, "We have to keep it alive to harvest its brain."
And what's really sucks about that is I read for that part. So just hearing about it pisses me off.
So do you think there's any chance Comedy Central will pull the plug on her special?
Inside Carly Fiorina? I don't know. I mean, this is another instance where she was at the debate and she said all this stuff that anyone with Google can or common sense can tell you is bullshit. All those tapes... That tape of the fetus was inserted into Planned Parenthood people talking, but it wasn't made by Planned Parenthood. It was yeah. it was this organization editing things together as the Planned Parenthood people are talking. Then you it's B-roll basically that they put in.
But is there is this a late term abortion that they're showing?
I don't know, but the main point is that she says this incredible bullshit that anyone can check and realize, and I knew immediately that when she was saying it that it was bullshit, and yet after the debate, all of the pundits were like, "Wow, Carly Fiorina was great. She really is the breakout star of this."
Nobody bothered to look this up.
Some people did, and like I'll get like, yeah, some people did look it up, but it was stuff like that is kind of never at the forefront of how these things are interpreted.
By the way, the term "a fully formed fetus" is an oxymoron.
Uh-huh. Right, that's a baby.
Yeah,
that's no.
Well, it's not fully formed if it's a fetus.
Right.
Yeah. yeah.
Wow. Carly Fiorina. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you.
I was just going to say she lost all credibility with me when Trump called her ugly. That was,
should we go with our gift? Is our gift ready? In 2 seconds. We have a birthday gift
oh, okay.
for you, Frank Conniff.
I heard some tassels out there, so.
Uh-huh. You didn't, and well, by the way, we're talking with Frank Conniff and Liam McEnany. Let's plug some gigs. Mm-hmm. Frank Conniff, where are you going to be? You're on the John Fugelsang show.
I'm on the John Fugelsang show 2 to 5 every afternoon, channel 121, Sirius XM. And I understand you're going to be on it on Monday?
I'm going to be on it, I believe, Tuesday.
Oh, okay.
And I was there last week,
right.
But you weren't
I wasn't there. I was out with a vicious gout attack. And... and so I'm doing that. And then if people are interested in a week or so, I'm going to be in Salt Lake City at Salt Lake City Comic Con.
You're going to be at Salt Lake City what?
Comic Con.
In Salt Lake City?
Yes.
Hold on.
Okay. And Liam, do you want to plug some gigs?
I'm recording my next album January 10th for...
Are you trying to...
Yeah, go ahead. We have yeah, hi. Hang on for 1 second. We have a gift for Frank Conniff that's coming up. But Liam, do you want to plug your gig, Liam?
Yeah, at the Bell House, January 10th, 8 o'clock.
All right.
Joining us from Hollywood, California.
Uh-huh. Ooh, Hollywood.
Is your birthday gift.
Uh-huh.
Say hello. Birthday gift?
Is that me?
Yes, you.
Is it me?
Yes.
Am I on where you can see me?
Yes.
No, you can't see me visually, can you?
No.
Wait, let's do it again. Hey! Happy birthday!
Hey, that sounds like...
Whose birthday is it? Is it a birthday?
Yes.
Oh, is it Frank Conniff's birthday?
Yes, it is.
Well, it was my birthday.
This is Andy Kindler, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow, that is a great birthday present.
Thank you. Thank
because
you.
I...
Hey, please, curb your enthusiasm. Am I right? Oh, God, I'm on.
Andy.
All right, now, wait a second. I'm pulling over. because I wanted to get to a place that was more quiet. Brooklyn.
When I'm on stage, the audience.
Can you see me visually? No.
No, we can just see the your name on the iPhone is what we can see.
Okay, so why was Alex, and I hate to bring his name up in general, why was he saying FaceTime?
Oh, well, we thought, because sometimes it's a cleaner signal, but that's neither here. The audience doesn't want to hear that. You have been...
The audience.
Andy has heard that phrase many times. The audience doesn't want to hear that.
Andy, you have been quoted as saying that Frank Conniff is the funniest man in the world.
Do you want to
say that to his face? Do you have the balls to say that to his face?
You think I'm scared? Just got scared. I'm somebody who's not. I don't care about confrontation. I'm afraid of complimenting somebody. I go the other way. This is a rough crowd. Let me tell you that right now.
Is he as funny as Mark Cuban?
Oh my God, Mark Cuban! Mark Cuban he loves Trump. I don't know why I thought Mark Cuban was better than this.
What did Mark Cuban say?
He's just like, I know you're gonna crush it, Donald Trump.
Oh,
he was playing at the Mark Cuban American Airlines Center. Uh-huh. I know you're gonna crush it. And meanwhile, when the whole rigmarole or hubbub or the thing about Donald Sterling was happening, Mark Cuban, just like Bill Maher, the people who say the most horrible things are the ones who are most nervous about free speech.
Right.
So Mark Cuban said when Donald Sterling was in trouble, I swear, he said this, he goes, well, I'm just worried about the slippery slope. I mean, where do we draw the line? Like, how about something anti-Semitic? In other words, that was down the slippery slope to him. Oh, we can't make fun of Jews next?
Well, you know, Andy, I would believe in love thy neighbor and do unto others as they would do unto you, but I'm not into that politically correct bullshit. Which is what they're saying. Which is what Donald Trump says when they say, "Oh, you called so and so a fat, ugly pig," and he's like, "Well, I don't have time to be PC."
I love how PC has been the you're so PC is the answer to anything,
yeah,
any horrible thing that you say.
And I know how the PC thing is really hurting us. I know everyone was really deeply saddened when Jerry Seinfeld stopped doing college gigs. When a multimillionaire turns down a gig, it's a tragedy.
Well, I think he's a billionaire.
Yeah, he may very well be, yeah.
I saw the interview with you in the New York Times where you came down hard on the word Massapequa.
I told you to bury that later on in the interview.
Oh, I'm sorry. But what you said was very refreshing, because there's this knee-jerk reaction to the PC crowd, and you were absolutely right. You are PC, correct?
Well, the thing that's amazing is that was the classic example where everybody already had their opinion. And they were waiting for, but it was a complete non-event. It was, they had their opinion, and they said, oh, see, Jerry Seinfeld. But Jerry Seinfeld, the first thing he says is, I don't play college. But the people who play them have told me, Jerry, stay away from colleges. So, I mean, literally nothing happened. Has Chris Rock's career been hurt?
No.
Nothing happened, and that was my big objection.
The real issue is why, when we're spending $60,000 a year per kid to send them to these schools, why would Jerry Seinfeld be wanted on a college campus? And why are we paying comedians to perform?
They can't afford him. That's why he doesn't play.
Yeah. But I mean, I was
for Chris Rock. Chris Rock doesn't, they can't afford these guys.
Yeah,
more hilarious.
I've been way ahead of this curve because I haven't been doing colleges for years.
We have we have adjunct professors on food stamps, but they have $20,000 over at Rutgers to have Snooki speak.
Yeah, the idea that I'll never get to perform for Melissa Harris Perry is just devastating to me.
Well, Andy,
you say for Melissa Harris Perry?
Well, she's a college professor.
I just can't believe that's almost too mainstream a reference.
Andy?
But by the way, I do want to say, Frank Conniff is the funniest person in the world. I remember all of his, he used to do a routine about Friends, where he would start to cry almost about the people, I have friends, they're in my demographic, and then his other classic, it's a good show. People like it.
Andy's a big fan of... Andy's a big fan of all the bits that got me nowhere in this business.
I cut you off, David. You're on.
Big fan. State of the union. State of the industry. Can we talk? Right. I have some questions to ask you because I don't watch as much comedy as you do. But you, what?
Where'd you go?
I'm there. Can you hear me?
I do, but you have a. You all of a sudden. This is the first time you've ever introduced dynamics.
What shows, because the Emmys are Sunday night, the 67th Annual Emmy Awards.
Oh, shit, I got to get my tux.
Oh, great, I'm nominated.
Are you?
Yes, for angriest person who watches James Corden.
All right, so
I saw a poster for James Corden today on the subway today. It said, James Corden, feel the irrelevance.
I don't even know when you're launching into a joke. That's how low-key you are.
I need to know how to feel. So tell me, in the late night wars, where you are a refugee currently, tell me how to feel about James Corden. What when I watch him, because he does make me feel good. He's likable. He doesn't tell any jokes that make me feel stupid. I get all his jokes.
Right.
So that's comforting for me. And then, if Matt Damon just walks on and everybody cheers and screams and is happy to see a famous person, in sitting in a hot tub, that makes me happy because there's so much pain and suffering in the world. And there's, I like to laugh without anybody being hurt, right? That's a good development,
sometimes,
right?
Sometimes you just got to turn your mind off, you know?
Well, no, I mean, that's what comedy is. Funny is fun, having fun, right, Andy?
That's right. He's putting the party back in, George Lopez put the party back in late night. he's making the party more interminable. Late night. So he, first of all, is so shocked that he has a show. He didn't even go into Les Lopez to pitch a show. He went in to pitch some kind of a, who knows, and Les Lopez said, why don't you take over a thing for me? Do a thing for me.
Yeah,
and they do these gimmicks. Do they still do the thing where they go to the dressing room of the guest before
come out? Mm-hmm. I know that when I watched the Jimmy Fallon show, I never knew that the most influential people in comedy would be the Parker Brothers.
What was Parker Brothers?
They made all the games, right?
Wasn't it Parker Brothers and Goober, the famous improv? I'm thinking of
the Higgins Boys.
Yeah,
and
that's
Goober.
Right.
David, why? Don't complicate the reference.
Sorry. I just want to learn, Andy. I'm trying to figure out what I should be watching. So now I like Fallon because.
All right. Well, right. Jimmy Fallon is so likable, you don't even care if his Trump impression is terrible.
I first of all, he doesn't have a mean thing to say to anybody.
No. And the one thing I hate in a comedian is a point of view.
And he's a great singer, and he's a great performer. Shouldn't that be enough in comedy, Andy?
Yeah, That's exactly. You know what? Have you ever heard the expression, you're bringing me around?
Ellen.
It's all about having fun.
It's all about Ellen. That's a great show, right?
Which one?
Ellen in the afternoon.
Oh. Ellen in the afternoon, it makes me feel like it's also raining outside.
Well, the Oscars are coming. The Emmys.
The Emmys, yeah.
Are you going to watch the Emmys, Andy?
I do. I will absolutely watch them. Who's hosting?
No, I don't know.
Andy Samberg.
Oh, Andy Samberg is good.
I will not be watching that.
Let me give you the this is what's nominated for Outstanding Comedy Series.
Oh, okay.
And I'd like to find out what Andy and you guys think. These are the nominees for Outstanding Comedy Series. Veep.
A great show.
One of the best shows that's ever been on television.
Mm-hmm. Pretty good.
Andy, Veep?
I hate to be a stick in the mud because this really is a subtle, this isn't like a slam on television, but I love The Thick of It so much.
I agree with you.
Which is the British version that this show is based on.
Right.
And I just don't think, and I love the actors on this show.
Uh-huh.
I just don't think there's any comparison because you know what the problem is? That's not the way politics are here right now. Whereas in England, that's exactly the way politics are.
Well, I disagree.
Hello?
Yeah,
hello?
I disagree with it. I thought The Thick of It is amazing. But think about
it. Let me finish.
Okay.
Let me finish.
But what about the fact that Julie Louis-Dreyfus is married to Brad Hall?
Mm, nice guy. I've met him.
Oh, no.
Uh-huh.
No, I've heard bad stories.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And that if she gets more successful, it's going to eat him up. So
how could that happen? How could she get more successful than she is?
Well, she wins another Emmy, and then Brad Hall feels even worse about himself. Mm. Less of a man. Or is that sexist, Andy Kindler?
Oh, you're nothing. You know, when people see you coming, they think misogyny. I don't know. I'm definitely, my rhythm is there, but nothing else.
Okay, now can we all agree? Now, I don't know Andy Kindler that well, but I know his taste in comedy.
Right.
And I know that the nominee for Outstanding Comedy Series that he is rooting for because of the writing is my... Modern Family, right? You're a big fan.
I like Modern. I actually like Modern Family.
Oh.
I've never
seen it.
Okay.
Oh.
What about, there was another comedy series, I don't know if it's nominated, that I was waiting for you to mention and to hear Andy talk about, which...
Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
That's what I say, Brooklyn Nine-Nine-Nine-Nine. Louie is the one I want to. Is that nominated for anything
this
year?
Andy hasn't made any comments about Louie.
I saw Andy.
Next season. Next season. His wife was white. Then his wife was black. Next season, his wife's a throw pillow.
But I really like the quirky way he presents the throw pillow.
He's so self-effacing, isn't he? Just like the real Louis.
But the great thing about Louis is he does a brand new episode each week.
which you're supposed
he
to do.
He throws it out. He doesn't use any of the words. From the previous episode.
It's a brand new show each week. How many stand-up comics can do that? Isn't that great that he has a new act every year, Andy Kindler?
Yes, because it's the act that you create in an artificial environment under a deadline of a clock. Those make the best specials.
I'll tell you, then this is a triumph for Andy. After I saw Andy at Caroline's a few months ago, and I stopped watching the Louis show after that. I decided I didn't want to like. I did like it before, but after seeing Andy, I didn't want to like it anymore.
Well, I actually watch any episode of Louis, so that actually. destroys my theory that it's bad, because I'll watch more than I'll watch many other things.
Mm-hmm. And Amy Schumer, she's I don't know if she can be at the Emmys, because she's probably picking up a Nobel Peace Prize.
I miss that one. I can't hear that well.
Oh.
Maybe it's me. Maybe I'm old.
But tell me about
Amy. I like Amy Schumer. She's funny, though. I think she's funny. There's some sketches on that show I think are very funny.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's
hello?
Yes. You're still there.
Cut my mic?
Let's go to Outstanding Drama Series, if you don't mind. Okay?
Outstanding who?
Outstanding Drama Series.
Okay.
I'll read you the nomination. The nominees.
Hill Street Blues.
Maverick.
Better Call Saul.
Great show.
Downton Abbey.
I haven't seen it, but I hear it's fantastic. I'm still watching Breaking Bad, which I love.
Yeah. Okay. Downton Abbey.
Great show. he thinks I'm being sarcastic.
You still think Downton Abbey?
I love Downton Abbey.
Still?
Oh, I haven't seen it.
I love it.
I will always cede to Frank Conniff's opinion.
Okay. Game of Thrones?
Never seen it.
I wouldn't say. Wait, don't tell me Mr. Selfridge is not on this.
No, are you upset? Jeremy Piven didn't even get no nomination for Jeremy Piven.
Best excuse for leaving a Broadway show?
Mercury poisoning.
Yeah, he had Freddie Mercury poisoning, which was even worse. That's an actual thing.
House of Cards, Kevin Spacey.
Great. Well, this last season sucked. I love the first two seasons. I thought this last season of House of Cards really blew.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you.
I'll tell you, I will weigh in as Ebert or Siskel. Let me tell you something. Those commercials that he does where you don't even know what the product is and he's walking down the street, those are my favorite things I have ever seen.
Mad Men.
I love that.
Great show.
The greatest.
And Orange is the New Black.
I love it.
I only saw the first couple. I saw it on a plane, so I don't know. Do you love it, Frank?
Yeah, I do. I haven't watched the whole new season, but the first two seasons I thought were great.
Yeah.
All right, we can't go through the whole thing. Let me ask you, Outstanding Variety Sketch Series. Ready?
I just wanted to throw in one thing that, a little known historical fact. Before F Troop, there was no show that was willing to take a light-hearted look at the slaughter of the American Indians. Before that.
Well, I think...
Nobody...
I think they felt comfortable doing that at that point because Hogan's Heroes had very successfully done it. They didn't think you could do a Holocaust comedy, but they proved that you could.
What do you
Letterman, right?
Well, the sketch series is Drunk History, Inside Amy Schumer, Key and Peele, Portlandia, Saturday Night Live. Let's talk about Saturday Night Live. I know you're a big fan of...
No. I'm a big fan of Lorne Michaels. He's the drink that makes the straw want to leave.
To me, there's nothing... When they have, big-time celebrity cameos in the sketches... And they come on, and the audience freaks out. That is good writing.
That is good writing. Right? You know what they always say? In movies, writing is editing.
Uh-huh.
In television, writing is casting.
Uh-huh.
And if you can cast a celebrity, that fell really flat. That was absolute death. The Colbert Report.
Do you guys still miss the show Bette, which starred Bette Midler? I do.
I haven't thought about that show in a long time, I'll be honest with you. Although we did mention Bruce Valanche earlier, so it all ties together.
Very quickly, the elections. I'm going to try to make a prediction here about you, because I've known you for a while.
Oh, but wait, can I ask Andy something? Have you been watching MSNBC lately, Andy?
Oh, my God. I love Morgan Yosef.
Oh, who is that?
That's Morning Joe in German.
Are you excited that they've added a fourth hour to Morning Joe?
What'd they add?
They've added, and I'm not making this up, they've added a fourth hour to Morning Joe.
Oh, God.
It's four hours
Frank,
now.
Frank, I have to ask you a serious question because I've stopped Googling for a few days. Was there, has it been announced that there was a decision to go like a right-wing network?
That hasn't, that's only been like sort of reported. But if you have been watching the network over the past couple months, it's very obvious that they have abandoned even the idea that it's a liberal network. And the thing that really made it clear to me was Steve Kornacki did a segment, is Alan Grayson the Donald Trump of the Democratic Party? And they were making like equivalencies between Alan Grayson, who's very passionate and fiery, and Donald Trump.
Grayson, who came from the Bronx,
yeah,
went to Harvard on a scholarship and got into Harvard Law School.
Yeah, and so the network is just... I actually have been trolling Chris Hayes lately on Twitter because he does these snarky tweets about Donald Trump, and yet his show shows Donald Trump's speeches uninterrupted. So I don't think you have a right to make snarky comments about how awful Donald Trump is, where at the same time you're providing infomercials for him on your network.
Well, but let me ask you this, Frank. Is it that they don't care at Comcast? Or, I mean, who do you think is the person who's decided? Because that is the worst. That Morning Joe, it's the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. It's
right.
Like, you can't say, like, well, I hate it, but boy, is it a fun fest over there. It's just awful. It's worse than IMUS.
It's worse than anything. It's worse than Fox News, seriously. And
worse than Fox News.
But I think the reason why Morning Joe is so established there, and I don't think it gets great ratings, but it does a great job of maintaining the status quo, and inside the Beltway people love it and feel very comforted by it, and they'll all go on it, and a lot of the show is devoted to let's have another person who's responsible for the Iraq war come on and talk about foreign policy, you know.
William Crystal is on like a regular.
Yeah, he's on all the time, and they have like Dan Seymour, and they have all of the neocons come. And, you know, Joe Scarborough was a big neocon, and he was a big supporter of the war and has yet to admit that it was a mistake. So it's just amazing to me that I've been saying for a while that my least favorite Fox News show is Morning Joe on MSNBC.
Chris Matthews lies that he was against the war.
Yes, he lies about that. He talks about, because he did write an article before the war that said that it might not be a good idea. But if you read the transcripts of Chris Matthews at Bush's Mission Accomplished event, you can actually see in the transcripts, you can see him jizzing his pants, actually. He is so excited talking. He actually says, women love this war. We love a strong president. We love a manly president like this. He won the war. He says that. He won the war.
Right.
And the people who are criticizing him are just, it's just sour grapes. And the next day he had G. Gordon Liddy on his show, because, you know, when you're at war and it's a very serious thing, so you want to have a convicted felon on to discuss it. And they literally talk about Bush's package, like how great he looked in that flight suit. And it's the idea that he would even still have a job after that is amazing. But not only does he still have a job, like all of the people who promoted and supported and celebrated the war, they're all thriving. They're all doing great. Nobody has suffered one consequence from it, except Judy Miller.
Oh, yeah, right. Exactly. And she's still trying to claim, like, it's so funny what you said that, because what Chris Matthews does, if you watch, I know that he did that because I watched almost, because I was obsessed with how horrible he was. I watched almost every episode of him leading up to the war. Once someone called up and said, oh, I think it's been, I think they're playing around with the intelligence information. He yelled at the guy. There's no evidence of that.
Yeah, so he did.
He is all over the map. So he's probably saying that article he wrote erases all
he
these
does.
Shows.
He does. In fact, they had a special on MSNBC called Hubris, which was about the lead up to the war, which had some good stuff in it about the arrogance and the deceit of the Bush administration. And then afterwards, they had a round table, and David Korn, who I used to like, says to, and Chris Matthews is on the panel, and he says, Chris, you were a lone voice who stood up against this war.
Oh, God.
Yeah. And it's like all these people just want to keep their jobs, and they're willing to perpetuate this kind of bullshit.
Well, they fired.
Who do I contact over there for a job?
I don't know, but they're very afraid of comedians over there. In fact, they don't have, like John Fugelsang, who's been on MSNBC and who would be an amazing host there. If he did a show there, he would double the ratings of whatever time slot he was in. They don't want him there because he's really funny, and he'll say things that Phil Griffin, the head of the network, will then apologize for, because they've apologized for the stupidest things at MSNBC.
It's like when Jay Thomas has a job as a disc jockey. And the billboards are always, we have to apologize for what Jay Thomas is going to say tomorrow. Remember that, Andy?
And he had a job as a disc jockey?
Forget it.
Jay Thomas had to apologize?
That was the advertising campaign when he was a morning disc jockey.
He still is a disc jockey. I see him at Sirius XM sometimes.
I want to circle back to something we were discussing earlier.
He does have the best anecdote in the business, though. He does have the best anecdote.
The Lone Ranger.
Which is the Lone Ranger.
All right, we want to circle back and get your take on this. Steve Renazzi.
Oh, let me push back on that.
Okay. Steve Renazzisi is a comic. He just apologized for lying about where he was on 9/11. Are you going to apologize, Andy Kindler, for 9/11?
I was in. All I said was I was in the South Tower.
But you did tell a lot of lies about 9/11.
Well, I'm not Jewish. Let's start with that. I actually have a very big penis. I always end with the weak reference.
Are you still denying that 9/11 ever happened? Are you still on that?
I'm a 9/10 truther. Somebody write the rest of that for me.
So I'm trying to.
I've always described you, Andy, as a mirther.
I've seen his mirth certificate.
But he has one, yeah.
He has one. Hey, Andy, I have a theory that you are not supporting Bernie Sanders, that you're a Hillary supporter. That's my theory.
As am I might add.
Frank, you're supporting Hillary?
Yes, I am.
Yay! No, here's the thing. I don't know why I said yay, because I was so angry at the campaign she ran against Obama. I hated that campaign. But I like to think it was Mark Penn more than it was Hillary Clinton.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think Bernie can. I don't think Bernie can win. I really just don't think he'll win.
You don't think?
Have you seen Adomian? Have you seen Adomian's video?
No. Does he do Bernie Sanders?
Oh, he does this whole Bernie Sanders thing where they say I can't party, but so they have him partying. But he keeps saying the bottom quartile of the bottom 2% is real tax. It's today's inflation tax dollars. So that. But I'm surprised, Frank, that you're supporting Hillary. I don't know why.
I am supporting her, and I get mocked because I do John Fugelsang's radio show, and I am frequently gently mocked for it. And I really feel that that we've really been burned by progressive candidates in the past. In other words, we get all excited about them, like Ralph Nader. And I know Ralph Nader and Bernie Sanders is a different situation, but I feel like in every election, in any presidential election you can think of, if we had only elected the Democratic candidate, things would have been much better, whether it's Bush and John Kerry, and certainly Bush and Gore, where Ralph Nader, where a lot of progressive people supported Ralph Nader, and to no effect. Nothing good came of that campaign, as far as I'm concerned. And whether,
The war, the Iraq war, happened before.
Yeah, and you know whether it's like Richard Nixon, people didn't get excited about Hubert Humphrey, and he would have been a much better president than Richard Nixon. And I think one thing about Obama is once he got into office, he wasn't as inspiring and as exciting to people, but he did the hard work of governing, very unsexy work of governing, and he accomplished a lot, and he changed things for the better, and that's what I want. I want a president who's going to be able to govern, and it'll all be, it's always incremental change, and people expecting someone like Bernie Sanders to come in and is going to knock down the system and change everything, like, I just think that's kind of a fantasy.
You know, Frank, everything you said, I couldn't have said better. And it's exactly, and it's been so kind of horrifying to be felt like I'm a pariah just to say, I almost felt like I think I just slipped it in there that I was in favor of that trade deal.
Uh-huh.
Or that it sounded good to me. Mm-hmm. And believe me, I don't know enough to defend my position about anything.
Mm-hmm.
So, But the thing was, is that, like, for example, with the healthcare thing,
mm-hmm.
and because people want a single-payer plan,
right.
does that mean that we shouldn't pass Obamacare?
Right.
No. Obamacare is an incremental change thing. He knew what he could pass and what he couldn't
right.
pass.
Right. I totally agree.
Yeah, so
remember when the affordable healthcare, when all that was going down and the fight over it, Obama was vilified by progressive people for not pushing for single payer. And I think we'd all prefer single payer, but I think Obama got done what he knew he could make happen. And now millions of people have health care that didn't have it before. And I think I feel like that's what I've learned from the Obama administration is governing is not exciting. But things change and things. So many things have changed for the better since Obama
yes.
became president.
Yes. Mario Cuomo said, politics is poetry, governing is prose, and I have no mob connections.
Hey, Andy.
Well,
go ahead.
Yeah. What's that?
I thought you were going to say something.
Oh, no, I was going to say, I really got in fact, I lost a lot of friendships over the last few years. Because I like Obama, I have lost.
Uh-huh.
But that's not the reason. It's the reason why I lost the friendships and a lot of friendships with comedians that I'm glad I'm not friends with anymore. Was because if you had told me that defending someone's right to be Muslim or to be a member of a religion would that just the fact that you're a member of a religion that you would be insulted and you would be attacked and called stupid. I mean, I can't believe that I've. That the way people of this like the new atheist thing,
mm-hmm.
and but I felt like alone with it sometimes. Like people didn't think like a lot of progressives, they don't think it doesn't concern them, so they don't think it's a problem. Maybe I don't know. I can't figure it out.
Can I ask you a couple of quick questions before we wrap it up? Where are you going to be in November? Union Hall. What are you doing at Union Hall?
Well, David, I don't know if you're familiar with this, but I do a little thing called. Stand-up comedy.
Yes.
And that's not what I'm doing at Union Hall, of course. I am a life coach for life coaches.
What are the dates at Union Hall?
It's the Friday or Saturday after Thanksgiving.
Right.
And you're going to be at Union Hall. And how do people buy tickets for this?
Well, if you go to the Union Hall's website, which is www-whatever.
And then hang on. http:////
Right. David, can you please use snail? Can you please use snail mail in a sentence?
Actually, I've just been informed that tickets for any show are only available at the box office. You can't get them online. You have to go there beforehand and purchase them in person, or you will not be admitted into the show.
So, a couple quick questions. The high holidays are upon us.
Right.
Yom Kippur. Do you fast?
Did I lose you?
Yeah. Do you fast on Yom Kippur?
No, I'm Kippur. It's not a kipper like a fish.
Are you gonna fast?
Yeah. Oh no. Here's the thing. I was bar mitzvahed. I don't remember much about it, but I remember I killed. The rabbi couldn't follow me. I went to a during my haftarah reading. I'm a cultural Jew. I don't really celebrate the holidays anymore.
I was talking to Ari Shafiro, who I'm sure you are a big fan of.
And Ari Shafir?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know Ari, right?
Everyone does.
I
still have a problem with him insulting that woman.
He's that guy that insulted the woman.
I asked him if it was true.
It's true. I saw a clip of the special. He did insult that
woman. I know, and I saw the whole thing. I said, that was a put-on, though. I mean, you arranged that.
No, it wasn't.
No, it was, yeah. It was for
And then he made up that whole thing about that woman and him at 9/11. It's bullshit.
But, you know, he was an Orthodox Jew, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and now he's a cultural Jew. And we agreed that, anyway, we're not going to talk about it. So you don't go to temple, you don't fast, you don't do any of that stuff.
No, but I mean, I will do, I don't fast. No, except for my special cleansing diet. Mm-hmm.
Do you believe in God?
I do believe in God. I believe in God, but I use the word God to describe something that can't be put into words. That's how I see the word God.
Andy, you don't fast, but I have heard you described as being from hunger. So,
I don't think fasting is good.
Would you work on Yom Kippur?
Yes, I'll work on Yom Kippur, and I will work. I'll heckle Orthodox Jews on Yom Kippur for the right price.
Okay, and you are.
I'll go to a Passover Seder if there's enough connections I can make.
That's a very spiritual approach, I must say.
All right, Andy Kindler, this has been a special treat for us.
It has. This has been a great birthday present, I must say.
It is. And
when was your birthday?
Last week, August 30th. This is a belated. And I had a birthday party. David Crosby of Crosby, Stills & Nash was there. Wow, that didn't impress him at all.
What about David Crosby?
He was at my birthday party.
He was?
Yeah, because John Fugelsang is friends with him, and John, it was at John Fugelsang's house.
You know who wasn't there at your birthday party? Young.
Young, no.
Because none of us are.
And Frank, do you know that I did an episode of Ellen with David Crosby?
Oh, I didn't know that.
I played guitar. I played a guitarist at like a rock and roll fantasy camp.
Uh-huh.
And David Crosby changed the strings on my guitar.
Oh, did he really? Wow.
Yeah. I borrow his turkey baster for Thanksgiving. And everybody's happy. Everybody's happy. So you're not going to temple? How were you raised? Were you Reform, conservative?
I was raised Reform.
You know about my background, right?
No.
You know that I was a Hasidic Jew, but they threw me out for wearing black after Labor Day.
Is that what it's come to? We have to actually sneak our actual jokes in.
Busted. Alex told me to. Alex said, "Do the Hasidic joke." I got a note. Do the Hasidic joke. You're busted, Alex. I didn't want to do that, Andy. They make me do it. Well, we love you, and I hope to see you soon.
I love you guys, too.
Thanks, Andy.
Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, and you didn't have to send a tape.
Your box is low.
You didn't have to send a tape this time. We put you on without a tape, having to see a tape.
Oh, I still can get your Evening at the Improv.
Thank you. Andy Kindler. All right, we're going to wrap it up.
I love you guys.
We just cut him off. Was that a good birthday gift
for
you?
That was great. I love Andy Kindler. Anytime I'm talking to Andy Kindler and hanging out with Andy Kindler, I'm very happy.
Maybe we can get him. Yeah. Well, I'm sure you'll have him up on the Fugle stage.
Yeah, we'll try to get him. And you should get him here when he's in town.
I don't know if we can get him unless we tell him you're having another birthday. He's amazing. And he's fearless. Could you say those things about, like, I guess in the New York Times?
Well, what's great about Andy, too, is, like, everybody has, like, people in the business they attack or whatever, but it's usually, like, easy targets, you know, like, you can attack the Kardashians or whatever.
Behind their back.
Like, Andy, like, attacking Louis, I mean, that was, like, very, you know, against the grain. It isn't. Most comedians and most people think he's a genius and think he's great, and it's really refreshing, I think, to get that kind of contrarian view. I remember doing a show with him at Largo in the 90s in L.A., and it was when South Park had just started, like maybe a year ago, and it was the hottest thing. All comedians, everybody loved it. And Andy did a whole thing about how awful it was in his act, and it was just amazing. And it was, and whenever he trashes, he doesn't just trash, and he comes up with a funny way to make his point. And you it kind of does alter your thinking a little bit. You're like, oh, maybe that isn't as good as I thought it was.
Yeah,
you know.
We'll put a link, Alex, on the website. We'll put a link up to his State of the Industry from last
year. Yeah, and that was I listened to it this year. It was really good.
He's fantastic. All right, so let's wrap up. Liam McEnany, where are you going to be?
January 10th at the Bell House. I'm recording my album with Comedy Dynamics. And it'll be $8. And there'll be a ticket link up on the website at the Bell House next week.
And tell your friends. You've been having some interesting guests on that show.
I did. Tell your friends History's Greatest Podcast, tyfpodcast.com. Recently we had Lawrence Block, who is a mystery novelist.
Oh, yeah.
And we've had Tom Leopold, who is
he's great. I just met him this year for the first time. He's a legend. I'd always heard about him.
Tell his great joke.
You tell. It's your favorite joke. I'm going to fuck it up.
Why did Hitler stay away from alcohol?
Why?
Mean drunk. That's Tom Leopold.
I think Alex told him that's your favorite joke.
I don't know if I'm going to do justice to this, but. He was on our radio show recently, and he was telling about how he was writing for something at Town Hall, and the joke that he wrote for someone was, I fingered Odetta here.
Frank Conniff, I'm going to be on the Fugelsang show with you, I think, Tuesday night.
Yes, Tuesday, and I'm going to be, like I said, at Salt Lake City Comic Con, and then Trace Blue and I, who is my partner from Mystery Science Theater, we're going to be doing live movie riff shows in Chicago in October, and then at the Alamo Draft House in Denver in November.
Oh, you know what? We have to do bonus material, Alex. So we'll do. You know what we'll do? We'll do our we'll do Emmy predictions when we come back. Okay. If you stick around.
Can I just say what an honor it was to be the placeholder guest until Andy Kindler could call in?
We want you here every week.
Okay. I've seen you on the show when it wasn't waiting for Andy Kindler to come on.
But it just felt like it.
No, it was when Kindler canceled.
I've done a lot of those. I've done those for you where it's last minute, you know.
Yeah, yeah. But no, I mean, no. You're like number one on my list of people.
Who are number two.
All right, so this is what we're going to do. If you want to stick around for our premium content, you know where to find it. From the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan, I'm David Feldman, and that'll do it for us. Thank you. Are you enjoying today's show? I know I am. Well, there's a very simple way to say thank you, and that's by shopping at Amazon. Yes, that's right, Amazon. Make all your purchases at Amazon through the David Feldman Show website, and we'll get 6% of everything you purchase. It's a pretty good deal. Next time you want to buy something on Amazon, first go to the davidfeldmanshow.com.